Thank you. again, we start a new series that they call Frangelism. And the purpose of this series is this, is a challenge for us as believers to see, are we committed to pointing our friends, our relatives, our associates, our neighbors in the right direction? And today, I want to share the point, friends. Listen, I have a lot of friends. And sometimes I find myself wondering, what would life be like if I didn't have friends? If I didn't have friends to encourage me in my times of struggle? Because I know some of you are very churchy and you're saying, well, you gotta be like David, you gotta encourage yourself. But every once in a while, David had a giant to encourage him. What would life look like if we had a world where there was no friends to encourage us when we're down? I find myself wondering, what would life look like if I had no friends to hold me accountable, to working out, to going riding? Like, I had a friend call me this week and said, hey, we haven't been riding in a while. You haven't been tweeting about you eating healthy anymore, because I haven't been. It was a hurricane. They had Bobo on the sweet cinnamon bread. Money's coming. But what would life look like if we didn't have friends to encourage us? What would life look like if we didn't have friends to hold us accountable to our goals and to us, our commitments to loving our family? What would life look like if we did not have friends? How about having friends to celebrate with you? A party in a party unless you have folks to celebrate with you. Like, when you graduate from college, it's not the same if you go to Red Lobster and eat the biscuits by yourself. Like, you need to have someone there with you, right? Like, last week we went with a friend out to eat at this fancy restaurant, and the meat was good. But you know what was better than the meat and the meat and the more meat and the lamb chops and the more meat? It was a lot of meat. But what was better than that was the friends around the tables and the jokes that we made. What would life look like without friends? I often find myself wondering, what would life look like if we had no friends when times are hard? When someone in your family loses a job, and maybe it was a loved one, and you didn't have a friend to call you, or to be there with you, or to stand with you, what would life look like without friends? Maybe it's only me. A friend is defined as a person whom one knows and with whom one has a bond of mutual affection. And that's what friend. And I know today we get it a little twisted because we think, well, I have 1,000 friends on Facebook. I have friends. They're not all friends. Maybe 10 of them, but the other 990, they like you just once in a while. Some of them don't like anything. You just kind of look on and see what you're doing. You think they're not looking, but this is stupid. You see that we're looking. I'm not talking about social media friends. I'm talking about friends. Friends, they know you. Not only do they know you, but they have a bond with you. I imagine you found yourself in a situation where you needed a friend. Have you ever needed a friend? All 5 of you needed friends. Me too, say 6 of us now. I mean, have you ever needed a friend when you've lost a loved one? Maybe you lost a dad. Maybe you lost a mom and there was a friend that stuck closer than a brother. Maybe you lost a job or you went to a job that you thought was good but wasn't great. Or maybe you struggled with a relationship and there was a friend that you can call upon. Have you ever needed a friend? Today I want to take a look at friends. There's a man named Robert Wick. He wrote this book called Touching the Holy. And in this book, this is my first point if you're a note taker, he said this, he made this point, and here's what he says. He says, friends are important for support, but are also necessary for psychological and spiritual support. Friends are important for support, but they're also necessary for psychological and spiritual support. And if you read the book, he kind of makes the point that without friends, you would go crazy. Just might lose your mind. Without friends, he even says, without friends, it's hard to grow spiritually. Listen, this spiritual walk, this journey of reconciliation is not a solo walk. It's not a solo dance. It is a walk that we do together. Listen, if we do this on our own, we will lose our minds. And so we need each other. Listen, even the Bible tells us that we need each other. When Adam was created, he was lonely, and God said, it is not good for man to be alone. And many of you think it's just, I need a woman, but it's bigger than that. Matter of fact, in Hebrews, the Bible says, do not forsake the assembling of the righteous. Because we need each other. So today I want to take a look at what the Bible says about friends. If you have a Bible, would you go ahead and journey with me to 1 Samuel chapter 18. Today I want to take a look at the friendship between these two male figures. The one name is David and the other one is Jonathan. Jonathan. And as you're looking for, when you find it, say word. For those of you who are still looking, let me give you a little bit of background. David and Jonathan had a lot in common. Number one, they both trusted and depended on the Lord. They both trusted and depended on the Lord. Listen, David is known for this big story when he fought a giant called what? What's a giant called? You're Bible scholars. And so we often see David in this story as he's fighting this giant called Goliath. But if you know the story very well, in that moment, in that battle, David trusted the Lord. He did not go into battle in his own strength. He trusted the Lord. He was led by the Lord. David and Jonathan depended on the Lord. And they trusted the Lord. And if you know Jonathan's story, Jonathan was a part of the army. His dad, he was like a second in command. And in 1 Samuel 14, you don't hear this story often, but Jonathan fought some Philistines too. And Jonathan didn't do it in his own strength. Jonathan trusted in the Lord. Jonathan had faith in the Lord. He went into battle saying, I want to see what God's going to do. So they have something in common. Not only did they happen to come and trust in the Lord, but they were committed to their responsibilities. Like David took care of sheep, they belonged to him. Like David would fight a bear for his daddy's sheep. Like David would fight a lion for his daddy's sheep. And when they were looking for a king, and they said to his daddy, bring all your sons, his daddy didn't even bring David to the table. But yet David was committed to his responsibility. And so was Jonathan, and they had that in common. Here's the last thing they had in common that I want to share with you before we dive into the text. They were consumed with the glory of God. Amen. They wanted God to be glorified and not themselves. If you have the word, would you join me at verse 1? Let's read together. I'll read it and you can follow verse 1. The Bible says in 1 Samuel, verse 1, it says, after David had finished talking with Saul, Jonathan became one in the spirit of David. And he loved him as himself. Now listen, you can't be friends if you don't know each other. Right? Like don't say we are friends if you don't know me. Right? We are acquaintances, you know, we're compadres, you know, we're not friends. We like each other, we're cool. But listen, David and Jonathan's friendship did not start until Jonathan and David. But you're saying, well, I don't see that. Look, in verse 1, it says, right before they became friends, David finished talking to Saul. And Jonathan was right there. And in that moment, Jonathan heard about David's heart. He heard that he took care of his daddy's sheep, even though he didn't own a sheep. He took care of his daddy's sheep like it was his own. He heard that David was a guy who served as unto God and not as unto man. And when he heard that story, it bubbled up in him. He said, me too, I'm one of those guys. I'm just like you. And when he heard why he fought Goliath and how he was fighting Goliath for the glory of God, he said, me too, because I fight for God. Yeah, he's like me. He's like me. And he heard how he was consumed with the glory of God. He's like, yeah, yeah. I mean, it's almost like when you're in a line, and for me, and folks say, I'm a Lakers fan. Some of you don't get this, but me and Leslie get this, especially rest of you guys don't cheer for me anymore. I'm hearing you for the heat. But anyway, like when I heard Leslie's a Lakers fan, I was like, girl, we were friends before, but now we're really friends because, ooh, you my homegirl, LA all the way. We might be better than Heat this year. Be honest. Wade's gone, he's no longer here. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying that when David told his story, and when Jonathan heard his story, he got excited. He said, I want to know him more. David does this commentary. He says this in his commentary. He says this, Jonathan heard David give an extended explanation of his part. His faith in the living God. And Jonathan knew that he and David had the same heart. They could not be such close friends until Jonathan knew about David. See, strong friendship begins with this, learning about each other. And this morning I want to share with you five elements of a friendship. We see in the text this morning, it's first one's in verse 1, we see that once Jonathan knew David, they became one in the spirit. They became friends. They became buddies. When I was growing up, there was this doll, that I was young then, and I wanted one of them. It's a doll called My Buddy. My buddy, wherever I go, you go. All of us who were in the 79, 81, 82, all of us are just, yeah. The rest of you guys are like, oh, I don't know what's happening. I'm from the island. We don't have my buddies. Jonathan and David became buddies. And you see this with the first element. If you're a note taker, the first element is this. If you're going to have a strong friendship, there must be love. And if you're going to have a strong friendship, there must be love. I mean, if you read verse 1, what you read here saying is this. Jonathan loved David. And when you read the story, you knew that David loved Jonathan. There was love. There was love. See, we don't love friends because of what they can do for us. You don't love friends because they can give you money. Because they're payday loan. Zero interest. Take forever to pay them back. You don't love friends because they pick you up from work whenever you call them. You don't just love friends because they help you move. Because they answer your phone when your husband's tripping, or your girlfriend's tripping, or your boo's tripping, or you just struggle with certain things and you call them and they're there for you. You don't just love friends because of what they can do for you. You love friends because of who they are. When I was in college, I worked as a waiter. And worked for Marriott. And it was a senior-living community. And so the folks who lived in that community were retired, many retired Jews, wealthy Jews that lived in that community. And they lived in that community, and we weren't supposed to take tips. And during Christmas time, they made an exception. They said, the whole year long, don't take any tips. But during Christmas, you can go ahead and take some tips. And listen, every single year during Christmas, listen, your boy was balling. I mean, I would get more tips than the supervisors and the manager. I mean, one Christmas I got for college students was huge. I got over $1,000 in tips. Hey, listen, if they used to make it rain back then, I would have made it rain. And I couldn't believe it. And I remember one lady saying this to me. She said, sir, come here, Arthur. She said, you see, every year I give you a tip. And I don't give them a tip. I said, okay. She said, you want to know why? I said, said, Ida, Ida, why? Tell me why, Ida. And here's what Ida said. Ida said, you show love all year long. They start showing love in November. You see, the first element of a strong friendship is love. It is not just showing love in November for a gift. We show love all year round. Like, if you're aware today, like, do you serve someone with excellence because you want a bigger tip, or do you serve them with excellence? When you see them as God's humanity, fearfully and wonderfully made by God, created in His image and in His likeness, and Christ died for them. Do you serve them because of their God's humanity, or do you serve them with compassion because you want a bigger tip? Give you some gas money. I'm not saying you can't take gas money, because I've been there in the past. Don't let them just always bring your gas money, give me anything. But your motive can't be about what you can get back. Your motive has to be because you love the individual for who they are. David and Jonathan love each other because of who they are. Love. You should love people because, not because they give us stuff. You should love people because they were made in the image of God, and Christ died for them. The second element, if you're a note taker, is found in verse 3. I'll give it to you. It's called commitment. 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 If you were with me, I'll read verse 3 out loud. Here's what it says. And Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. Covenant. The word covenant points to a commitment in a relationship. Way back in the days, in the Greek culture, in Hebrew culture, whenever they would have a covenant with others, like the original weddings back in the days, they would wrap an animal, they would cut the animal in half, and they would split the animal in two. And when you made a covenant, whether I made a covenant with you about something, we would walk through the animal, and that was a sign of saying, if I don't fulfill my part of the bargain, if we don't commit to one another, what happened to that animal should happen to us. And David formed a covenant with David to show his commitment. His commitment. His commitment. I did a wedding last week on a Sunday morning at 6 a.m. in the morning, ungodly hours. Had to get up at 5, drive to Bell Harbor. And I had a chance to be a part of the wedding celebration of Larry and Christina. And when Larry and Christina came together, I saw tears going down Larry's eyes. And in that moment, he gave his vows. He was making a commitment. He said, I'm forsaking all others, and I'm with you. See, God is a covenant with us. When He says, I am your God, you are my people. I'm with you, you're with me, we're ready to die. And so often we break our end of the bargain, but God still pursues us and loves us, even though we're not committed the way He is. Commitment. It's something you'll see today in many areas of life. We lack commitment. But if you're going to have a strong friendship, there has to be commitment. And covenant points to a strong commitment. And the question is, are you committed to your friends? How committed are you to your friends? Are you committed enough to point them in the right direction? Remember, when I was younger, I had a friend who started smoking. Like, man, you need to start smoking with me. I remember he pointed and said, listen, Kareem, that's not cool. And even when it hurt, even when he didn't like what I was saying, I just kept pointing in the right direction. But now today, can we point others in the right direction in the area of their faith? Are we committed to pointing our friends to Jesus? Commitment. There's a song, maybe you know it, I don't know it very well. It says, in good times, I'll be by your side forevermore. Some of you are sleeping out of the day this morning. That's what friends are for. And Stevie gets it back. I can't do that. I'm messing it up. I'm like, go back to the notes pastor. Yeah, Stevie does that part. But listen, friends should be committed in good times. Friends should show commitment in bad times. That's what friends are for. Commitment. Let me give you another point. Point number three is giving of yourself. Giving of yourself. In verse 4, we see Jonathan giving of himself. And if you don't know what symbols Jonathan was sharing here, you missed the point of the story. In verse 4, Jonathan took off his robe he was wearing, and he gave it to David, along with his tunic, and even his sword, his bow, and his belt. Now, don't miss this. Because what Jonathan was saying in this moment is that I'm going to surrender my rights. What interview he was saying in this moment? He was saying, I should be next to Israel, but I see something in you. I feel a call upon your life. I'm going to surrender my right to be the next king so that you can be the king. I mean, what Jonathan did in that moment was said, David, you're the king. Here's my sword. You're the next commander-in-chief. He surrendered his right and he gave it to David. He said, if we're going to be friends, there are going to be moments we give of ourselves. We surrender our rights to that answering the call, our rights to that going and being in your authority. We got to surrender our rights every once in a while to be there for our friends. Now, let me tell you this. Friendship has to be give and take. Listen, if you have a friend and all they do is take from you, they're not a friend, they're a moocher. Say with me, they're a moocher. Say it again, they are a moocher. There you go. Moochers. So don't get twisted. Some folks will call friends who are moochers. They don't never give back. And there's no responsibility. It's all you can give. Moochers. Now listen. If you're the one who's always taking, you're a taker. But moochers are the folks who take from me. If you don't want to take all the time, you're a taker. And if all you do is give, and you don't give that, you're being used. Tell your neighbor, if they don't give back, you're being used. All right, you guys don't like that. Don't get my business pastor. Listen, giving of ourselves is about putting people first. Our family verse of the year, they might be able to hear us forever, is Philippians 2 and 3. And here's what it says. Do nothing out of vain conceit or selfish ambition, but in humility we value others more than ourselves. In this moment, Jonathan was valuing David more than himself. Who would give his right to the throne? He was supposed to be the next king, and he was willing to surrender his right to be the next king because he saw something in David. You know, that's how we show in life. We don't want to surrender our rights. We want what we want. Even when the greater good is accomplished, we just want what we want. See, it's important to have people who are willing to surrender your rights. Listen, if you're going to grow spiritually, if you're going to grow psychologically, you have to be to have two things. One, you have to have people who are pouring into you, and you have to have people you're pouring into. And you have to have folks that are pouring into you. You've got to be in a position. Stop living in isolation. That's a downfall of our society today. Is we all want to live in isolation. We have traded community for privacy. That's why we're struggling. None of your business. Get out of my business.
He
says, we don't need a pill. We need to be committed. We need to confess our faults one to another. Why? So we can pray to each other. If she gossips, go tell her, but tell the one who will pray. We need to recognize those. In this moment, Jonathan does something that's powerful. It foreshadows somebody else. It foreshadows Jesus. And Jonathan surrenders his right from his friend. And I remember John, I think it's verse 13, the Bible says, Jesus is my Lord. In John 14, he says to them, I've been your friend all this long. I'm going to prepare a place for you that where I am, you'll be there also. And my favorite disciple, Thomas is like, Jesus, we don't know where you're going. He says, you do. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And then in chapter 15, verse 13, I think, don't quote me, but I think I'm right. He says this, he says, a man laid down his life. What greater love than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friends. Jesus laid down his life for us. You see, what Jonathan did by giving up his right to be king, Jesus said, I'm going to give up my right. I'm going to come down to this earth, and I'm going to live the life you should have lived, die to death. You should have died, but I'm going to give up my life for you. Why? Because we're friends. I'm bigger than your friend. You surrender your rights to your friends. The last two will be a lot quicker. Number four, if you're taking notes, is celebration. Celebration. Let me jump down to verse 6. Here's what it says. When the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine Goliath, the woman came out from all the town. There were cheerleaders. The women, like the cheerleaders, they came out from all the town to Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing. They were singing and dancing, and they were joyful songs, and with timbrels and with lyres as they danced, they sang. They said, Saul has slain his thousands, but David his 10,000s, and Saul was very angry. He refrained displeasure. It's pleasing greatly that they have credited David with 10,000. He thought, but me with only 1,000. What more can he get but the kingdom? Saul didn't celebrate David. He had a little gain from David winning his battle, but he didn't celebrate David. You know who celebrated David? Jonathan. Where did you see that? When he took off his robe, there was celebration. When he gave him his splinter, when he gave him his sword, when he gave him all his possessions, he was celebrating David. Listen, if your friends can't celebrate you, they're not your friends. If they can't celebrate you because you're in college, they show you how to celebrate you by your home. If they can't celebrate you with your put-put car, they definitely have to celebrate you when you can buy cash, the other car. If they can't celebrate you at 30, they must struggle celebrating at 35. If they can't celebrate 5 years of marriage, they'll struggle celebrating 10. Real friends celebrate their friends. Real friends grab a car and say, you go, Clayton. You go, Richard. You go, boy. Michelle, you the bomb. You go, you go. Real friends celebrate friends. Haters don't celebrate you. That was Saul was. Haters hate. Friends celebrate. They celebrate you. They celebrate you, they break you, they text you, they call you, they celebrate you. Real friends celebrate something they want to celebrate. He's a hater. Sometimes they become haters too. I pray that the spirit of haters will become those who are celebrators. My last point before I pause for a moment. The fifth element of strong friendship is having each other's back. If you know the story, Saul decided to kill David. And when all army turned on David was a man named Jonathan that had his back. Later after that, Jonathan died. Jonathan is called died in the war. I can read this in the Bible. They died in this war, and the family thought that David was now going to be in charge, and he was now going to pay Saul back for trying to kill him. So they grabbed Jonathan's son, and in a rush to try to make sure he gets away and not get harmed, he falls to the ground and he's disabled. And they run with him. And then one day David calls for Jonathan's son. And then he thought he was going to kill Jonathan's son to pay back Saul for all that he did. But because David had Jonathan's back, he said to his son, he said, listen, I want you to sit at the table. I want you to enjoy the work of your father and your grandfather. I want you to enjoy the blessings. And he was like, well, I thought you were going to kill me. He says, no, I have your daddy's back. I remember when my grandfather, my grandfather was a fisherman, and there was this young man named Bird who was fishing with him, and he trained Bird how to be a fisherman. And after a while, my grandfather started getting older, and he sold his boat to Bird. He sold it for cheap, too. And he would think that Bird, and probably don't see Bird anymore, but no, every week Bird came to the house, and he brought lobster, and he brought fish, and he brought silver, and he brought shark and dolphin. He brought every week, he didn't touch a penny. Every week he came by, and he brought, my grandmother got sick, he still came by, and he brought, my grandmother died, he still came by, and he brought, Bird brought stuff until he left for Anguilla. Why? Because Bird had my grandfather's back. Why? Because when my grandfather died, he had Bird's back, and he discipled Bird, and he trained Bird how to be a fisherman. See, real friends have each other's back. I want to pause for a moment and ask the lady to come to the stage. This is the lady, turn. Yeah, that can be turned. And Sister Lee, I want to ask you a couple of questions. And I hope they're not too difficult. Sister Lee, I've been watching Sister Lee. Sister Lee loves her friends. She's so excited about her friends that she keeps pointing them to Jesus. She keeps inviting them to church. And every week I'll see a new friend. And I'm like, oh, Sister Lee. I'm Sister Lee. And I was like, man, I said this. Forgive me if I offend anybody. You know what I said? I said, listen, we had 100 Lee Turners, we would be a mega church.
Amen.
Amen. Not even more time to be a mega church. But we might create a culture where we have friends back. And a part of that is pointing to Jesus. So I want to ask you three questions. Why do you invite your friends to church?
Because inviting friends to church is very urgent and important. Urgent in that I do not know when they are going to die, and I do not know when I am going to die. And it's important because God commissioned us to do that. I love my friends, and I want them to be saved. I will be saved when God comes.
Amen. That's right. I'm going to stop right here. Do you ever find yourself praying for your friends?
Yes, I do.
Why?
Because it's important. Prayer keeps them going, and it keeps me going. And when I pray for them, they will keep coming. Like I have Esther here and Corey over there. I pray for them because it's important. I pray that they will remain faithful to God.
Okay, this is my last question for you. You can answer it real quick. Why do you think it is important that you point your friends to Jesus? Beyond this break in the church, why do you think it's important that you point your friends to Jesus?
Because God commissioned me to do so.
That's
and because I want them to be saved.
Amen. Can we give up for the return? Your price is Pastor, why do you do that? Real friends point your friends in the right direction. Real friends point your friends to Jesus. As the first thing is ready to come, I want to share with you four crucial roles that your friends should play in your life. a very important factor of our lives, whether there are people in our lives with whom we can trust and who are able to play a number of crucial roles in our lives. I'm not sure if you have four roles. I'll be honest with you, come right down if you want to. The four roles are this. Number one, prophet. Prophet. And you say, okay, I need a prophet in my life, Pastor. Well, not really. You need someone in your life that plays the role of a prophet. So let me explain what that is. They say the things that need to be said. Even when it gets uncomfortable. Even when it brings discomfort. And you need to have the strength that tell you about yourself and don't care about what you're going to think afterwards. You need a prophet in your life that are going to tell you the hard things, that are going to stand before you and be the mouthpiece. Some of you don't want those in your life, you need them. Number two, you need a cheerleader. You need that friend who's going to grab the pom-poms like Tito and are going to celebrate you no matter what. I need those friends that when my sermon sucks, they come on the stage and they're like, "That was the best sermon in the world, Pastor! Woo! The world will bomb!" Yeah. But I need those prophets who kind of say, "You shouldn't have done that. Did that." Not who I need. I need those cheerleaders that when I think no one's cheering you on, you need to have that one person that when you think you've lost the battle, they still have their pom-poms waiting for you to get back up off the ground. You need to have that person in your life that when you stumble and you fumble the ball and you think that game is over, and you look around and they're there cheering you on. You can do it. And you don't believe in yourself. You need to have that cheerleader, just cheering you on. You need a chief. You got that chief. Give you an O. You got that O. Now go. You need to have not just the cheerleaders, but the harassers. And if you want a better word, you want to have the realists in your life. Those who allow you to see perspective. And when you think things are all, well, my marriage is falling apart, and they say, no, it's not. Or you can say, well, the church is in trouble, you know, we almost met budget, but we didn't. No, listen, this is folks who are closing doors, we're going to be okay. But when you get too hot, and you think, I'm the best person in the world, they say, oh, no, you used the reason about it too, so come on. We need to have those harassers. We need to have those realists that will keep it real. But we also need those spiritual guides. Those who will guide us spiritually, because you see, we so often worry about physical fitness and trying to look right and trying to make sure these things don't bite anymore because I put on some weight and you want to have those things harder physically. But you need those spiritual guides who can challenge you to grow spiritually and to go forward in your faith. We need those guides in our lives. And so when you don't have any of those folks, you don't have a prophet who tells you things the way people tell you and hold you accountable. You don't have maybe that cheerleader who cheers you on. Maybe you don't have that cheerleader. You need one. Maybe you don't have a harasser who harasses you and you just see perspective. Maybe you don't have a spiritual mind. I want to challenge you today to know that you need them. You need them. My question to you today. Do you have a friend? Do you have a friend that loves you? Not what you can give them, but because of who you are. Do you have folks who are committed to you that when the rubber meets the road, they don't bounce like Tigger, but they're still there with you? Do you have those who are giving of themselves? Are you giving of yourself for them? Do you have those who will celebrate you when no one else will cheer you on, but they're there cheering you on even when you feel in your last place? Do you have those who have your back? If you're here today and you don't have a friend, I want to challenge you to be your friend. not only is committed to you, but he has your back.
Say one of them.
But I just want you to invite them to pray for them. Pray that they would know Christ as a friend, as the one who laid down his life for them on the cross. If you do that, pray for them and invite them. I dare you to do that. Trust God to do this. Before we close, I want to pray for Sister Raymore. She got home, has two fractured ribs. So we want to pray for her right now. Father, we pray for our sister. God, we pray to you, Lord God, because you're able to heal the broken. You're able to heal all diseases. There's absolutely nothing too hard for you. So God, we pray for her as she sits in that hospital room, wherever she is. God, we pray she would sense your grace and your peace, that you would be with her always, even until the end of the night. God, have your way. Now, to him who was able to keep us from falling and to show us faultless before the throne of grace, thank you, Lord, for being the only wise God. Yeah. To you, you have all dominion, all power, and all glory. And the church shouts,
amen.
Have a great week. Remember your sign. Love you. Take care.